Thank you. So yeah. Yeah, not all the issues. Maybe we also responsible. Some of the issues gets closed and not responding. So sorry for that. Yeah. We're gonna talk about the life cycle of an Appium command. So I'm sure like everyone in the room's been working on Appium, or at least would have done some sort of spike, or you've been working on your projects and stuff, right? So we're gonna talk about what exactly happens behind the hood for the specific commands which you actually run, right? To get started, a very quick introduction about me is I'm Sai Krishna and I work for ThoughtWorks. And I'm with ThoughtWorks for about 4 years now. And I maintain and also contribute actively to the Appium repo and open source. Yeah, just learn and give back to the community.
Yep. Myself, Srinivasan Sekar. Appium member, maintainer, Appium's Java client, and open source contributor in various open source repository. I also work for ThoughtWorks.
So, the agenda for the day, and not for the day, for the session. So we're gonna talk about the session creation. So I'm sure everyone should be familiar about the new Android driver, the new IOS driver command. So that's exactly what that's like your first line after you key in your capabilities. So we're gonna talk you through what exactly happens when a new Android driver and a new IOS driver actually is executed. And another one what we wanna cover today is about find element. So I know most of your client, all the client codes say that driver.findElement by ID, XPath, or whatever that could be. So we're gonna talk about how exactly that command gets executed and what exactly happens, what are the node modules called, and stuff. Problem statement. I always like to start something with a problem statement because I like problems. So yesterday when we were a part of the workshop, so we had a advanced Appium workshop, we had an awesome bunch of people in the room. Anyone from the workshop in the room? Wow, yeah. So, and some of them actually bumped at this crazy error saying socket exception, and even people who were not there in the room, how many of you have bumped at this exception when you're working in your projects? You know, you try to execute and nothing happens and all that you see is a socket exception, right? And how many of you feel that the issue is just closed, it's just ignored and no one's fixed it? Yeah, let's be frank about it, right? Yeah. So I've picked one of those crazy exceptions, why we close that, and basically let's try to debug as a part of the life cycle to see when exactly this exception actually happens, so that when you go back, it's great that even you now understand what's happening. Which node module you need to look into, where exactly is the problem and stuff.
It kind of remembers me a fun fact. If you type who broke the build in Selenium's IRC channel, it bumps up Simon's name.
Yeah. anyone on the Selenium IRC channel in the room? Oh, yeah, Pooja's here, yeah. So you would know that, right? Yeah, similar way, if something's actually broken on the Espresso driver, probably it should be Daniel. Is Daniel in the room here? No,
maybe.
He's not around.
You folks need to catch hold of
Yeah, you should catch hold probably. Of Daniel. He's going to be around somewhere. So he's one of the person who's very actively contributing to the Espresso module. So if something is broken, then I'm sure it's him. Because whenever I go back and he says, yeah, I know I broke this, I'm going to fix this. Yeah. So quickly on the Android architecture, right? I'm going to briefly talk about the Android architecture. Basically, what you see on the left corner is the client. So your client could be either it's your Java client or your Ruby client or your C Sharp, or Python, JavaScript, like WebDriver.io. I love WebDriver.io. Yeah. And so typically, what do you do in your client? You try to create a session. Then you say driver.findElement by ID by XPath. You give some locator to it. And you try to do a click, send keys, scroll, and all of this stuff you do typically on your client, right? So When you actually do that and when you run your test, what happens? So that goes into the Appium server on our W3C protocol, and the Appium server gets the request from the client, and Appium server is smart enough to understand whether it's a iOS request or an Android request, and it's going to send it to the respective drivers. In this case, we're looking at Android, so let's talk about Espresso driver. I mean, why did we actually pick Espresso driver? UI Automator 2, so Appium also has got another driver module called UI Automator 2, and we also have another module called Appium Android Driver. So let's not talk about Appium Android Driver, because that was UI Automator 1, which is completely like old. I don't know if I've started my automation at that point of time. With UI Automator 2 is officially deprecated by Google, and they actually very actively maintain Espresso Driver, but it is not deprecated by the Appium community. We still maintain it. We still have users using it. The whole reason being, we just moved into Espresso Driver, and we are actively building stuff, contributing, and just trying to make it more stable. But down the lane, at some point of time, Appium would actually deprecate UI Automator 2 as well when Espresso Driver gets into a stable state. So start looking at Espresso Driver, play around with it, report bugs, contribute to the community. So that's the sole reason why we wanted to actually pick Espresso Driver and take you guys through what exactly is happening on Espresso Driver. And if you want to know more on UI Automator 2 Driver, please attend Shravan's talk, which is bootstrapping on Android. He's here. Yeah. So attend his talk to know what are the internals of UI Automator 2 Driver. So we are going to talk the internals of Espresso Driver today. Yeah. And you have a server. So basically, the server is installed into your real devices or your emulators. So any request which comes from the server to the Espresso Driver, that is sent into the server which is residing inside your device. And that server is your Espresso server. So we have a driver, we have a server. Okay. So that's basically how each and every command just flows through internally inside your driver. So let's go through to a bird's eye and see what happens into all of that. So coming into the Appium-based driver, right? So actually Appium, the three different drivers actually extend Appium-based driver, like the Android driver, Espresso driver, and UI Automator 2. So we're gonna talk about Appium's Espresso driver. So we also see like other two modules, which is called Appium ADB and Appium's support. So basically Appium's ADB is a wrapper around ADB. So I think most of you know the Android debug bridge, right? So we typically try to do ADB devices, you do your ADB, you know, dump system and all of that stuff. So all those ADB commands have wrapped into that specific module. And the ADB support is more a utility function module there. Basically, if I have to give you an example, so it's got some functions like, you know, if can tell me if it's a Mac machine, Mac OS, if it's a Windows, or something related to your file systems and file utils. So all of those stuff you'll actually find inside Appium support. So going forward, we're going to see how Espresso driver, you know, takes help from Appium's ADB and Android driver. As I said, Android driver's like got most core of UI Automator 1, but still there are some helper methods where we're actually still using that, because we have a lot of helper methods regards to the old ADB debug bridges. Okay, so let's look at the Appium's Android lifecycle on a bird's eye view. Is the typical four stages which I want to take you through today. Is I've just broken it down so that it could be easy for us to understand what exactly happens on the initialization phase, and then we create. So what exactly happens in initialization is about your driver creation and stuff. And in the creation, when a driver is getting created, what is happening inside that? And instrumentation. We'll talk about what is instrumentation, why we need to instrument your APKs in Espresso, and how do we do it, and things. And then finally is the execution. So how does your commands actually execute on your real devices or your emulators? So as a part of your initialization, I'm sure everyone in the room who's at least looked at the README of Appium should be familiar with this piece of code. So basically what we're doing is we're just creating an object of desired capabilities, and we're just giving some basic capabilities like a device name and you know, app package and your app path and app activity. And you also see an automation name that is Espresso, right? So if you want to choose a UI Automator 2 driver, you actually give your automation name as UI Automator 2. If you want to choose the Espresso driver, you basically give your automation name as Espresso driver. And yeah, that's a very common line where you want to create an object like new Android driver in the mobile world. For Selenium folks, it's going to be new Firefox driver, new Chrome driver and stuff, right? So that's basically where your driver gets created. This piece of code is the one which creates the driver. So let's go deep dive into it and see, I mean, what happens underneath, right? What exactly goes through, what are the things that the different node modules actually pick things, how they move forward, what they do and things. And so we're falling back to the main Appium base driver. So basically, Appium's base driver, this module actually has got all the W3C protocol proxies, and also it validates all your given capabilities. So like when you give a capability, you could also give an invalid capability, right, which does not exist at all. So it actually validates and checks if this is a valid capability, so that the whole thing is we want to fail fast. So we just want to, you know, fail fast and tell the users something's not right, so probably you need to go fix these things, right? And when we talk about W3C protocol, right, is it the client or the server which sends and understands? So it's typically the client which actually sends the request. So when we send the request from the client, whether it's your Java client or Ruby client or any of those clients which you use, it's the client which actually sends the WC3 request to the server. And when the server looks at it, okay, I'm getting a W3C request, so which means I'm going to create a W3C session now, okay? And with Selenium 3.x, we have support to both W3C protocol as well as your JSON Wire protocol. And what Appium did was, we actually exposed a capability where you can actually force sending a backward compatible of mobile JSON protocol as well. But once we migrate to Selenium 4, which means it is default to W3C, so which you cannot go back to the old protocol. Okay, so going forward, once it's Selenium 4, the clients will always send a W3C protocol to the server. And once the server gets that, it knows it's a W3C request, and it's just gonna go ahead and take things up. And app launch state, right? So what happens in your app launch state? With your desired capabilities, basically it's gonna decide what should be the app launch state. So there could be capability like no reset, so which means you're saying Appium that do not do anything to my app state, just go ahead and execute only the test, let the app be in whatever state that could be, right? So we have a lot of these capabilities, so basically it depends on those capabilities, it decides what should be your app launch state. And if you want to know more on capabilities, you should definitely attend John's talk. He said that there are about 180 capabilities. That's a good stuff for you to go through. Is Jonas in the room anywhere? Yeah.
Yeah.
There he is. Yeah. So probably attend his talk if you want to like know more on what are the different capabilities that we have in Appium around iOS, Android, and how that could actually help you in your test execution. Yeah, you should definitely do that. And once we actually decide on the app launch state, and that's when comes your automation name. So in your capabilities, you provided automation name as Espresso driver or UI automator too, right? And what the base driver does at that point is it goes through your capabilities, it takes your automation name, and that's when it actually pulls that node module. So it says, okay, I'm getting an Espresso session to be created, so let me require the Espresso module. Let me import the Espresso driver module now. So at this point of time, the base driver actually imports the Espresso driver module now. So which means all your navigations are moved into the Espresso driver, not to the UI automator route. And once the Espresso driver has been imported, it just returns the driver from the base driver saying, okay, it's gonna be an Espresso driver going forward, so we'll just return that. And Espresso driver actually extends base driver, and what happens after that, right? So we're actually inside an Espresso driver module now. So keep that in mind. Just try to imagine you that you're debugging flow. So you come into an Espresso driver module now. And we basically, as a user, you would have given certain capabilities, right? Because when we saw in the previous slides, you say desired capabilities of new capabilities, you gave some capabilities. So that's something which is, flexible to the user, what you want to give, apart from the mandatory ones. So there are some mandatory capabilities as well, which Appium actually needs as a part of the Espresso driver, is something like a take screenshot, right? So if you say driver dot capture screenshot, so which means you need to actually enable, that should be a default stuff which is set, so we don't tell the user, I mean, just go ahead and give it a true. So we are setting some of the default stuffs over here, and we try to merge both the capabilities together. So which means whatever you have given, as well as what are the default capabilities that the Appium actually needs for the test execution. So which means we are still preparing for the state of our test execution over here. And once we actually merge into this, that's when we actually jump into the start server session now. So now you know the capabilities have been prepped for us, right? So what's the next that we actually need? So you need to know where to execute your test, right? So to know where to execute your test, you actually need to know what devices are connected. Are there devices in my system? Are there emulators in my system? So if not, you need to fail fast, right? You need to come back and say, user, I can't find any devices connected. Could be you, most of you might have seen that throwing some errors saying that, please set Android home, we can't find in things, right? That basically happens at this point of time, okay? And to get these device information, we actually get into Appium's AndroidDriver. As I said, that module still holds a lot of Android helpers for us. So we just jump into the driver. Typically, what you manually do, like ADB devices, that's exactly what we tend to do there as well. If we have multiple devices connected into your system, all that we do is we take the first device, because there are multiple ones. We just say array of zero, we pick that, and we get it out from here. Okay. So once you have the devices, you have the device to execute now. So what's next that the Espresso driver actually needs? It needs an ADB session, right? So when I say ADB session, so typically when ADB devices don't detect, you know, the common Stack Overflow, which says do ADB kill server, do start server. So basically you're playing around with ADB over here, right? So a similar way, you need to create that ADB session and give it so that you can go ahead, play around a lot of things with ADB, which is required for us. And we actually create the ADB session using the Appium's ADB module. As I said, that module is the one which is basically a node utility wrapper around all the ADB commands for us, right? And what happens next now? Because you know the devices, so you know this device, you've already created your ADB session, so you can go forward and take control of ADB, that's the Android debug bridge, to perform any other actions and installations and stuff, right? And then you basically get into initializing the server over here. So what exactly we do in the server initialization, right? So if you look at these in the server initialization of Espresso, so we have the devices, we created the ADB, but the next is we're gonna prep the Espresso runner. So because that's the one that's gonna execute your test cases, right? So we're gonna prep the Espresso runner out there. And if you see some of the capabilities there, you see anything with dot options, OPTS, is something what you have provided, right? If you have provided, we're gonna actually take those capabilities, because if you see, there are capabilities which is very specific to Espresso. If you look at one of the capabilities called Force Espresso Rebuild, that's just for Espresso, not for UI Automator 2. If such a capability is actually set, we are gonna actually get those capabilities and prep. So we are still prepping now. We have not just gone ahead. So we are prepping for the Espresso runner session now. And once that's done, and that's where you actually get into instrumentation. Okay. What typically is an instrumentation, right? So basically, when you say instrumentation, you need to actually instrument your Espresso server and your APK. So basically, both these APKs should be signed with a single signing certificate. And what else does Espresso driver actually do with as a part of the signing, right? So it unpacks your app under test, and it re-signs it with a certificate, and then it unpacks your server, and server's got a manifest file, okay? So what Espresso server, the way it works is, you need to take your app package, that's your app under test package. So every application you test will have an app package, right? Something like com.qa. Whatever your company's package that specific app has got. So it's gonna just use ADB modules, take the app package, and it's gonna bundle the Espresso server with that target app package, right? And why it should do this? Because Espresso needs to know which application that I need to communicate and I need to interact and do all my actions. And that's the reason we actually, as a part of instrumentation, we take your APKs, app path, and we try to dump it inside your Espresso manifest file, and Appium Espresso driver bundles it. So which means your Espresso server is ready, and the server's manifest file has got your test app under test package name. So and next is we go ahead and do a port forward over there. So you see this command called ADB forward TCP 8300 TCP 6791, right? Yeah. And just above that, you see something called a system port and a device port.
So just to emphasize on system port, right? Like that's when we establish a communication between our Mac or Windows PC with the mobile application and the test which is residing under our mobile device. So system port is another capability that enables port-to-port communication. So if you give the unique port, that's when we start running our test parallel. So in order to run your test parallelly on Android using Espresso or UI Automata 2 server, you have to mention a unique system port. That's when communication between our mobile devices are unique to the system port.
Yeah.
So that the sessions won't collaborate.
Yeah. So once we do the port forward, so which means 8300 is a port which is available, which is free in your machine, or wherever your devices or emulators are connected, and 6791 is the default device port. When I say device port, it's your either emulator or your real device where your Espresso server is actually running, okay? So Espresso server, because when it's a server, you basically need a port to communicate with it, right? That port is 6791. And you really can't communicate to a server which is running somewhere like just in a device, right? So we try to do a port forward to it, which means you take control of that, you can actually communicate to that specific device over HTTP. When you looked at the architecture, it's all HTTP, right? The entire architecture is a HTTP protocol there, yeah. And as we saw, we have instrumented the app. We're going to install the app as well. So Espresso Driver is actually installing the modified server as well as your re-signed app under test. And once that is done, so which means now, because the port forward is already done, so there's a communication channel open between your system and the device, which could be either your emulator or your real devices, right? So even now, we are still only at the installation process. So you have the app ready, you have the server ready. It's just about installations and stuff. So what happens next, right? Because now things are ready now. It's all available in your devices. And that's when the actual start session happens. So if you look at that command, which says shell am instrument, blah, 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 and it says test APK package and the Android just runner, JUnit runner, right? So what typically that command would do is, when you run that command, even if you run it manually, so that's what Espresso Driver does there internally. It triggers that command, and that command would launch the Espresso APK, that's the server, inside your device. So when the server gets triggered, and now you know we've configured a port forward stuff, so which means the server's up and running, and you can start communicating with that server now. And that's what APM does there as well. Okay. And once the communication is actually open and it's all good, so which means it just triggered, it ran the command, but doesn't matter, the server is immediately up and running, right? Maybe the server takes time because could be for X number of reasons, right? And that's when what we do from the driver is we hit the status endpoint because the server is running. You did a TCP port forward, so you have access to that specific device through REST. So through HTTP, you can actually communicate, start communicating with that device. And that's exactly how APM actually does that. And what we tend to do is we do a slash status, do a get, and we do a retry, because maybe it takes some time, maybe the device is slow, network, it could be X number of reasons. So we try to poll for like 20 seconds with 1 second of interval. And once we get a 200, boom, we got a result of 200, so which means the server's up and running. So which means the app is still not launched. So the app launch is still up. So we just have the servers ready where the server can accept any request from Appium now, right? And you see there's an if condition in the catch block which says has socket error. So we'll fall back to the problem when we started off, the socket exception. So when people keep talking about socket exceptions, so which typically means if the server inside your device does not respond in 20 seconds, right, it's going to throw a socket exception because your server is not responding there. And that's why you actually see that error. So there are two possibilities. Either you need to check what's actually happening because your system cannot communicate to the server, or why the server cannot respond back to the client in your machine, or maybe you need to retry more number of times by setting some capabilities, right? And once it gets a 200, that's when after that we do a slash session. That's another endpoint in W3C. We do a post. With the post, we give the capabilities what you exactly gave, right? And we also merge certain capabilities. And once that command is triggered and it gives a 200, that's exactly when app actually launches in your device. So it was not even with the status, it's actually with the session. That's when your app actually launches out there for you. And that's exactly the post call which would be made with a slash session. And those are exactly the capabilities which you have provided at the start of your client, right? You say desired capabilities equal to new capabilities. That's exactly the capabilities which goes as a JSON into a post method there. Cool. So let's see a very quick, interesting demo. Whatever I explained now is all about the driver and the way we do ADB port forwards and stuff, right? So which means there's nothing to do with Appium's mechanism and stuff. It's just that we're just putting things together. So what we have done now is let me show you a very quick demo on whatever we spoke on the slides. I've just put all of that manually now. So which means I'm gonna So if you see there, we're doing the AM shell, the same command which we saw inside Appium's Expresso driver code. So we have done a port forward on 8300 to the device. And I've just opened Postman now. And as I said, it's just a HTTP stuff. I'm hitting localhost 8300 because we did a TCP port forward to the emulator which is running. And I'm doing a slash status, and you should get a response with 200 OK and a body there. Yeah, you see there, I got a 200 OK with an ID, and it says the session ID is null and value and stuff. So let's try to open that app, right? What exactly the Espresso driver does is I'm doing a slash session, and I'm just giving the object of the capabilities, and it's a post now. So there's no Espresso server, there's nothing running now, right? So because the server just passed it out to the driver, and it's the Espresso driver who's responsible for that. So you see the app launched, and in the response, you get a session ID, and it says, OK, I actually launched the specific app activity and the package. Cool. And that's where your new Android driver session creation actually takes place. Sweet. And I'm going to let Srini talk about some of the crazy things of iOS on how the creation actually happens.
Thanks, Sai, for picking the easy stuff and talking about. Now comes the painful part of our life. So iOS session creation. Yeah. So let's get into our problem statement. I hope everyone has faced this problem. Yeah. Anyone didn't face this problem? WebDriver agent has a Xcode build failure returning a status code of 65. Anyone didn't face this problem when you were executing for the first time in real iOS device? Cool, only lesser hands. So let's get into, let's go and deep dive on Appium's iOS architecture and see how we can debug this problem and where exactly this problem comes from, which node module that returns this kind of error. So let's quickly jump to Appium's iOS architecture. Similar to Appium's Android architecture, we have client libraries wherein we code about desired capabilities and driver.find elements and creating the sessions. So that talks to Appium server through JSON, it was JSON Wire Protocol, and now it is WebDriver Protocol. So Appium has a backward compatibility now still. And Appium server talks to Appium's iOS XCUI driver. If we give a capability name as XCUI, that's when it picks up iOS XCUI driver, and which internally talks to Facebook's WebDriver agent. Why Facebook's WebDriver agent? Let's go ahead and deep dive on Facebook's WebDriver agent in the upcoming slides. So it kind of sends the commands to Facebook WebDriver agent present in the mobile device. That's when WebDriver agent talks to your application under test present in our mobile device. So if we go one step further and see where it exactly starts from when you send the command of desired capabilities and try new iOS driver, it all starts with Appium's base driver. So it has two automation drivers in it, so which is it can talk to Appium's XUI driver or the Appium's iOS driver. Appium's XUI driver is the recent one, which is like which internally talks to a couple of other node modules that Appium has. One is Appium's Xcode, wherein it's a wrapper around Xcode modules in order to get information around what kind of Xcode is installed, what version of Xcode is installed, what is the derived path where your applications are building in your Mac PCs. And we have another module called Node SimCTL. It's a node wrapper on top of Apple Simulator Control Library, which helps us to get how many number of simulators and what is the platform version of your simulator, what are all the UDIDs that a simulator has, and all other informations about simulators. An APM IOS simulator, specific to a particular simulator, if you wanted to know about platform version of that particular simulator. So that's when this node module comes into picture. So APM IOS simulator is a wrapper, again, as a node module to get details about a particular simulator, whether it is of type IOS, or it is of platform TVOS, or it's a platform watchOS. So all this information can be gathered through this node module, APM's IOS simulator. And we have another node module called remote debugger, APM's remote debugger, which helps us to communicate to web views or Safari. When you give the browser name, this is one taking the control. This is the node module that takes the control and passes or proxies the commands to the Safari browser or the any other web views when you have a hybrid app or automating an hybrid app in your day-to-day life. Let's go for a bird's eye view of how does iOS lifecycle looks at. So similar to Android lifecycle, we have four stages over here. One is initialization, and next is the creation phase, and next comes the app installation, then web driver bundling and web driver installation, then comes actual execution. So let's go into each and every step and do a deep dive on it. So coming to initialization phase, wherein we have given all our desired capabilities. For example, for a simulator to be, in order to execute your application under test, in order to install on a simulator, we used to give two desired capabilities called device name and platform version. There are two ways to interact with a simulator. One is by giving device name and platform version together, and another is by giving the appropriate UDID of the simulator itself. So either by giving a device name or platform version, or by giving the UDID of that particular simulator. So in order to talk to a real device or interact with the application under test on the real device, we have to give a UDID of the real device connected to that Mac host. Then APM's iOS driver kind of takes the server URL where exactly server is running, and then it sends the desired capabilities that user, as a user that we have paused on. So that's when the initialization actually happens. So coming to base driver, the node module exactly takes care of automation name. So in case of iOS, automation name here is XEUI. When the user provides automation name as XEUI, it kind of loads XEUI driver module. Instead of a iOS driver module, it kind of loads XEUI driver module. And if you have any other desired capabilities like no reset, full reset, so we kind of give all these resets together and bump at our code and make sure that our script doesn't work right most of the times. So doesn't give all the desired capabilities, try to give the appropriate desired capabilities. If you give no reset, that's when it decides on, it takes care of taking a decision about whether the application launch state has to be clean or it has to be take the cache altogether. Yeah. So that's all the decision that it takes to. So once the XEUI driver load module comes and loads into picture, it kind of extends the base driver again. So if you imagine, it starts with base driver, it goes to XEUI driver now, which merges the capabilities, that desired capabilities that we provided with the default capabilities of the driver. It started with client code, went to base driver, then it went to XEUI driver now in the lifecycle. So it kind of merges the capabilities, and lets if the capability is of type device name and platform version, then it assumes, okay, it's going to be a simulator. So it uses a node module called node simctl to get all the existing simulator and figures out whether the platform version has that simulator as well or not in your PC. If it doesn't, it just throws an error. So sometime back, it used to create a simulator by itself, and some versions back in the APM, it used to create a simulator by itself and then launches our application under test on it, but now it's not the case. And now then it goes to another module, node module called APM's iOS simulator, wherein we got the simulator name for that corresponding platform version, but I need to know the further details about the simulator. So that's when it talks to APM's iOS simulator node module, gets all the information about that particular simulator. Apart from the platform versions, what does the UDID of the simulator, and it gathers all the informations. So there are another way to Another way to interact with the simulator, which is by providing the UDID, it checks, it gets all the connected devices first, checks whether the UDID is present. If it doesn't, if it's not present, it goes to simulator, checks whether any other simulator has this UDID. That's when it returns real device as false and the UDID. If user has provided the real device UDID, then it gets the connected device match against and sends the real device as true. That's what happens over here.
And just to add over here is why we actually, the first line of get devices still talk to iDevice ID. And after that, we again check with iDevice ID. The whole reason being is with simulators, when you give an UDID, it gives you all the properties of it. But whereas with a real device, it only gives you an UDID. So we first list the UDID, take the UDID, again go back to iDevice with iDevice info, and get the properties of that specific device. So that's why we fall back with two different commands for real devices.
So we did the initialization now. Now let's go ahead and figure out how does the installation happens. So in case of simulators, as you all know, it's going to be an APP file that we use to install in our simulators. So it again uses NodeSimCTL library, installs the application under test in your simulator. In case of real device, if the application is already installed, we give bundle ID. So it checks for the bundle ID and launches at the later stage. So if the application package is given, IPA is given, then it go ahead and installs the IPA into the real device using a node module called IOSDriver, using a library called IOSDriver. So let's get to the painful part of the session, that is the WDA itself, WebDriver agent. Facebook officially deprecated or archived this WebDriver agent, though they started this project when XUI APIs were broken. They rewrite those APIs and released it as Facebook's WebDriver agent a couple of years back. So Appium kind of adopted that project and maintained that for a long time now. And even Appium internally uses WebDriver agent to talk to application under test through the XUI commands. So similar to system port, we have a system WDA port here, wherein a Mac host can talk to a WebDriver server, which is running in the device. So if the installation is successful, then that's when the communication and port forwarding happens between the two ports here, WebDriver port and the default port that WebDriver agent is running on, which is 8100. So when it wants to start the execution,
Just to add a point over here on the way it communicates to the real devices, Appium actually uses a bundle called iProxy if it's a real device. So it goes through iProxy over the USB mux. So that's how it actually communicates from your device to your system when the port forwards have actually done.
So coming to execution phase, right? So it kind of starts the WebDriver agent. So if the WebDriver agent successfully started, that's when So there is another phase called signing phase that happens. So in order for, in case of a real device, we have to give the signing authority so that Apple IPA can be installed in our real device. So if the signing is successful, then it successfully installs WebDriver agent in the real device. If it doesn't, that's when it throws the error. Just getting back to the problem statement where export build failure with the status code 65, so it comes from XUI driver module, which throws because the signing authority is different. It couldn't sign the application with the signing authority given. So coming to, so if the WebDriver agent is installed and started, then comes the real phase of hitting the API similar to Android. It hits the API endpoint slash status. If it is 200, just go ahead and start the application under test, which is still styled by Appium server. So now we have server is up and running, then it starts, kind of does a post session that we have seen similar in Android. It does a post to session with the desired capability, so application under test also gets launched. So communication happens, so everything is successful there.
Cool, so we did see the creation of Android driver as well as iOS, so which means your app is actually launched in your emulator, simulators, or your real devices, right? So that's when the step execution from new Android driver just falls out. It comes to your next line of code. So what exactly is then your next line of code, right? Everyone should be very, very familiar, or should be like super easy to read this. So that's exactly what we do to interact with any element, right? You say, find an element, either by the locator, either one of the locators, by accessibility ID, XPath, iOS locators, or whatever the locator strategy is, right? So you write this piece of code and you actually run. So the client actually converts this code into a REST, like you see over there. It's a HTTP, and the method is a POST in this case because you're trying to perform some action. And it sends a request because when we saw the demo, we did see the session ID is actually created, right? So that's when your app gets launched, the session ID is created. So we send the session ID as a part of the URL. So you see WD hub session, and that's your ID of the session. And you see slash elements. So what is slash elements? That's an endpoint. Like any other API, that's an endpoint, okay? And for this, you actually need to send a payload as well. And what does a payload hold? So the payload actually looks for two arguments there. One says using, another one is a value. So what is using, right? So using should always get what sort of locator strategy it is. So in this case, it's accessibility ID. It could be an ID, it could be an XPath or stuff. And your value should be your ID. So which means what exactly you're inspecting, right? So you use Appium desktop to inspect certain elements. You take your IDs and XPaths and stuff. So that goes into the value args and stuff. So this typically is just sent to the Espresso server, and the server executes this. And if this command goes a 200, it's going to give you a 200. If the element is not found, which means Espresso can't interact with that element, it can't find it, it's going to give you a 404. And that's when we map it back saying that element, no element found exception and stuff you would see on your client, right?
Yeah.
That's exactly what happens over there. So let's quickly look at a demo out here for this. I'm again using Postman and stuff to drive and show you how exactly this happens. Yep. So because we already have the session created, so I have the session ID with me. So right now what we're doing is we are still doing the same localhost 8300, and I'm trying to get the element ID. So basically, you know what the element is, but you need the element ID to interact, right? So I'm just saying slash element, and the value is accessibility with a login, and that's going to give me an ID. So that ID is the element ID of login. So I'm going to take this element ID, and I'm going to give it to our next API, which is called slash click, right? To the click command, I'm going to give this element ID, and that's exactly what Appium from your client to the server to the Espresso drivers actually do. And I'm just trying to replicate that using Postman so that it could be easy for us to understand. And now we're just going to do a click. You see the click happened and I got a status 200. And it also returned me back the session ID and as well as the ID. And this way we actually go forward with any sort of commands which gets executed.
Cool. So this helps us to debug any issues that comes up during our test scripting, or it can also help us to contribute back to the community as well, as we said before.
Yeah. Yeah. And thank you so much.
There is a special mention for a couple of people. One is Manoj, and another one is Kazu.
Yeah, these guys took a lot of time to help us put things together and run through what we have done and things. Yeah, big round of applause for them. Thank you so much. If they're around anywhere here.
Yep.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you, Srini and Sai. These guys deserve like huge round of applause, making our life easy, writing Appium tests every day.
Thank you.
And thank you for coming and sharing the insights. This maybe, if we talk about like bringing contribution from outside, people feel fear. But now if I see this single command line just executed in Postman, it becomes easier and I can go and look at it.
Yeah.
So yeah, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So we have 2 minutes for maybe we can take a couple of questions. Anyone?
Hi, this is Santosh. So I have a question like in comparing UiAutomator and Espresso Driver. Mm-hmm. So in UiAutomator, we used to use same session to handle multiple bundle IDs with different apps. So you mentioned signing is required for Espresso Driver. So does it mean like we ended up only testing with only single app?
Yeah, the answer is yes. So with UiAutomator 2, you can actually move between apps. But with Espresso Driver, you cannot. So it's targeted to a specific app. So you can only interact with a specific app. But there was a contribution by Rajdeep where you can actually use mobile colons only for find elements for UI automated too, but you can't switch between applications.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. Yeah.
So currently, there is no authorization, to be honest. Yeah. So, summarize, it's a simple server that just access a router without any authorization.
Sai, I have a question. So how it works in case of XPath? Because in Expresso, we do not have XPath strategy. We usually have r.id or r.classname, etc. Because in Espresso, we used to find using onView on data, and how it basically parses your XPath to corresponding Expresso component.
Yeah. So very recently there was another contribution. We did cover this as a part of yesterday's workshop, which is a new locator. I don't know if it's in any of, I think, I'm sure it's in Java client, but I don't know if it's contributed of any of the other clients. So it's called find element by data matcher. So basically, exactly what you said, right? So on anything that Expresso driver does, like on data or on views, the child views and stuff, you can basically use your Hamcross assertions as well as a part of it and send to the locator, which is find element by data matcher.
Okay, so in that case, your XPath won't work with Espresso. We don't to explicitly use the on data matcher. Okay, fine. And one more question. So how it works in case of a shared preference? Shall we do shared preference? Because Espresso give the liberty to ingest value in your shared preference. So using Appium Espresso driver, is it possible to do so?
I'm afraid so I don't know. Maybe Srini can answer.
Personally, haven't tested it. Probably you have to test and raise it if there is any issue. So